Now, our afternoon speakers, we have two afternoon speakers. On the one hand, we want to talk very much about the PhD students and their experience in integrating entrepreneurship with their work. And then we want to talk about the extracurricular work that a number of people, including Michael, actually mentioned earlier on the day. So, Michael has been involved in teaching entrepreneurship in NUIG for a good few years. I have to say, I've said this to him, I was surprised when he applied to come into the module with us last year. But I was very happy that you completed it, Michael.
Thank you.
And so much so that I'm quite interested.
Even if I was late.
Even if he was late, yes, that's true. And Michael and I both work with the Electors competition that we're going to be discussing in the second presentation with Laura later on. But I thought it was very interesting what Michael had to say and what he was working on in terms of integrating entrepreneurship into the PhD students' experience. So, Michael, the floor is yours now to cough any further.
Thank you. So, I work on a lecture in Big Bad Wolf of Entrepreneurship Education, particularly University in Galway. You know, the bastion of entrepreneurship education, who owns it, theoretically. The traditional style of causal model of entrepreneurship using business plan. The reality is that's not me at all. In fact, I'm an engineer. I graduated as an industrial engineer, with a postgraduate in the Master of Engineering Science at Galway before heading into industry for about 25 years. So I only returned back to education in the last 7 years. I did an MBA in between, so I even have that box ticked. And I've worked in different types of firms, from startups all the way up to multinational corporations. So when I came back to work in the School of Business, mainly strategic management was where I kind of kicked off. But I had a real interest in particularly enterprise. I grew up as a young student in NUI Galway, where really, in the main, nobody piqued your interest to be enterprising. The expectation was you go and get a job. You qualify, you get a job, you go do something for a period of time. But nobody kind of said that you could make a difference. So when I came back, I wanted to find opportunities to help students believe in themselves as people who could be enterprising and make the most of opportunities. So I'm not, I've no vested interest in business plans per se when you talk about entrepreneurship education. So I would have kind of come to it more from a greenfields perspective and sort of open a bit like a sponge to different ways of thinking about entrepreneurship. And that's the reason that I would have taken the module, is because I knew there was a lot to learn that I hadn't learned. That I hadn't taken the time to read, and it forced me to read material that perhaps I should have. With hindsight, I learned things in the module that I could have incorporated into this module a little earlier, and it might have helped, but at least I'm ready next time around to do that. So that's a bit of preamble. Where all of this started was back in 2008, the Deans of Graduate Studies in all the universities have come together, and they put together a statement around what are the skills and competencies that PhD students should have the opportunity to develop, and hopefully will develop as they pursue their degree program. Somewhat alien, you know, for PhD students, the notion that they're going to develop their skills alongside achieving a particular dissertation. So they would put a set of skills together that says that these competencies should help you as a PhD student work through your degree program, but then be ready to join whatever form of employment you enter. And the reality is, for PhD students, that has changed significantly in the last 10 years. The opportunities to remain within academia are slim, particularly in the Irish context. So either you travel or you go and find work in industry. From my own personal experience, one of the reasons I took this opportunity to work with them was I worked for many firms that refused to hire PhD students because they felt they were too specialized, they were too long in the academic system, and they were going to be hard work. So it was easier to hire master's students or high-graded graduates, undergraduates. So when I looked at the statement, it was sort of a combination of events that came together. When I was looking through this particular statement, these are the four things that the deans were saying PhD students should have the opportunity to develop. So understanding the role of innovation and creativity in research, demonstrating awareness and understanding of intellectual property, appreciating the skills required for the development of entrepreneurial enterprises, both in the public and private sectors, and finally understanding different cultural environments, including the business world, and the contribution that knowledge transfer can make to society. The big objectives in terms of providing the opportunity for skill development, I'm very mindful that some universities have, you know, really taken it on and driven on providing opportunities for that. DC would be an example. UCD and Trinity, obviously with their Innovation Academy, have set up a whole cadre of modules that focus in on this particular area and try and again scaffold through a set of modules the opportunity to do that. I wouldn't have had that same scope and opportunity. I was approached by the Dean of Graduate Studies, Lucy Burns, who had heard about some of the stuff that I was doing with undergrads. And we had a meeting to discuss, could we do this for PhD students? Could we do something in this space? But it would be only 5 credits, and it would be 1 semester long. That was the challenge. How do I make it happen within that framework? But it was an opportunity that I felt was too good to miss. A lot of people in the university, particularly in the business school, would probably look at me as a bit of an idiot, in that I take on pretty much every opportunity that I get my hands on. And they would say, Michael, you have 700 undergraduates to work with in the first semester, you have almost 400 in the second semester, and you also have other postgrad students. Plus you run the BioInnovate program, why would you do this? Because for me, entrepreneurship education should be multidisciplinary, it should be cross-university, and it shouldn't be owned by a business school. A business school can be a pivotal component to facilitate it. So it should never kind of say it shouldn't be with the business school. It should be alongside the business school supporting you. But it has to be away from a lot of the traditional thinking in regard to entrepreneurship and entrepreneurship education. And that's a challenge for many people who've looked up their careers, you know, understanding entrepreneurship in the traditional sense. And, you know, struggling with the idea of let's park the business plan, let's focus on design thinking, let's focus on prototyping. That's a tough one for people to kind of cross that Rubicon. I had the opportunity to do it without having all that baggage, so I guess that sort of helped. Through some of the material that I've learned on the module, it helped me understand what I was trying to do, and it gave me a framework to help me. So I give you the plug before you even try. I would strongly recommend anybody who is interested in this space, you know, that hasn't taken the module, to really give it consideration. This gives you an opportunity to reflect and think on some serious thinking that's gone on in this whole particular space. I was particularly taken with Lenker et al. In terms of their view on 4 paradigms of entrepreneurship education. And, you know, over here, we have kind of very traditional type thinking, creating new ventures. And start moving into just transforming ideas into initiatives that create economic growth. But still kind of a Schumpeterian thought process in regard to economics and economic growth. Then you start to move into the whole area of social change, and maybe entrepreneurship has a role to play in that. But it's the fourth one that is the platform upon which all those other 3 are built. Facilitating an entrepreneurial mindset in everyday practice. And for me, if there's anything I can do, if I was to walk away from the university in 5 years' time and somebody said to me that you built a spirit of enterprise and entrepreneurship in the wider sense in this university, then I'd be happy. I'd walk away. And just back to PJ's points in regard to Sarasvati and things like that, it really fits in here in terms of that type of thinking. So for me, and again, we would have come across this in the course of the module. If you take this definition of entrepreneurship, it creates a wealth of opportunities for people who are interested in making something happen, who have the desire to make it happen, have the energy to make it happen, and the willpower to make it happen. You can pretty much put almost anything under entrepreneurship, because it's a mindset. And you can go into the social space, you can go into the private sector space, it doesn't matter. It's just a mindset, and it's a definition that helps you believe in whatever you're doing, regardless of whether it follows traditional entrepreneurship education, or modern entrepreneurship education, social entrepreneurship education. ticks all of those boxes for me anyway, and certainly helped me as I was preparing for a set of PhD students who I knew were going to be a challenge. I don't know how many of you have worked with PhD students on a regular basis to ask them to do things that wouldn't be normally part of their day-to-day work. A few nodding heads. So the opportunity that was presented to me was, could I create a module for what were known at the time as our Hardiman Research Scholars? Since then, they were kicked off in 2011. In 2013, there is now a new set of Dr. Tony Ryan Research Scholarships. And basically what they get is a stipend of €16,000 plus their fees over the course of 4 years to pursue a structured PhD in these five areas, any of these five areas. So my class has potentially got students in all of these particular fields. And the challenge that I had was, could I present enterprise entrepreneurship and innovation to these students in a way that they could walk away at the end of the semester and say, that wasn't a waste of time. I really got something from them. So I knew that was the challenge facing me. As it so happened, the cohort that I had to deal with had students in all particular colleges. So well represented in the College of Science and the College of Arts. That's so engineering, medicine, and we have three from Business, Public Policy and Law. So all of these students here in particular, many of them would have regarded entrepreneurship as a bit of a dirty word. Something money about it, Wall Street. Why would I even bother? It's going to sully my thinking to think of me as a potential entrepreneur. That was the challenge faced. So I had limitations. I had five ECTS, but I had a compulsory module. Okay, so there are only a number of compulsory modules that students must take. One is a module that they take in first year, which is called Introduction to Creative Difference and Innovation. And in their, it's a challenge for them as well, but the Burnham College of Art take these students for a weekend and introduce them to creativity in very artistic ways. Some students get it, others think, what a waste of time. Right? And they would have left that first year module thinking, oh heavens, I've got to do this now in third year. But I could see some people were more open than others. I mean, I've kind of figured that out over time. And it's one of the things that I would have done in terms of setting it up is I didn't give them an awful lot of detail at the start as to what they were going to have to do, because I knew I was going to have to change it. I was going to have to flex to whatever was going to work with this cadre of students. Because at the first sign of something that was causing them extra workload, they would have their supervisors in like a shout, saying, this is a waste of time, I'm not letting a student do it. Right. That would be the reality. It was a question of assessment. This was very much pass or fail. Did you engage? Did you show reflection? Did you deliver on requirements? So you didn't have to get first class honors. But you didn't have to show a certain amount of engagement in the process. And what they would have had to do was attend a set of workshops over a set of weeks, which again were challenged by a number of them. One girl, I think, had to go to Hawaii in the middle of it for some research for about 3 weeks. And reflective essays were important and assignments that were given, but they also then had to work in groups, small groups, which again for PhD students, a huge challenge. They're located in different parts of the university. Even getting together is a challenge. And then at the end, I was challenging them to present their research. And some of them immediately cringed at the notion of having to stand up and present their work, even though they're ultimately going to have to do that anyway. But then I said to them, you've got to do it in 3 minutes. You've got to present your potentially 4 years of work in 3 minutes. And immediate pushback from everybody. There's no way we can do that. My work is much too important to present in 3 minutes. I need 20 minutes. That was just the reality. That was the immediate thought process that I had. That changed. You're probably getting a sense that I do tend to gather my wand at times. So anyway, to try and fulfill some of the skills and competencies that would be looked for by the deans, I structured it into four components. Understanding the role of innovation and creativity, I would have looked at innovation and applied creativity, and I would have brought in some of the folks from the Burton College to connect back to what they had done, to try and give them a new context for it. The notion of that creativity that they may have sparked back in first year that they may now be applying in their research, but there's another way of potentially applying it. On intellectual property, it's relatively straightforward. I have a lot of resources that are available to me to come in and not only, you know, present kind of the theoretical components of intellectual property, which the reality is very boring, so you have to be careful how you present it, but to bring in people who are running businesses who have intellectual property and how they've managed that process. Particularly young startup companies, not much older than themselves in many cases, how they've managed to work their way into having something that is working, that they have control of, and that they're managing. entrepreneurial behavior then was challenged through the group project, which would have focused on design thinking as kind of core, and it would have got them into thinking about business model canvas presentation of a problem that they, as PhD students, were encountering. Could they come up with a solution to a particular problem? So again, it's a problem of interest to them, but they also had a potential customer base available for validation. And I think that was, again, one of the reasons for stretching around it. And then we got into preparing them for a research presentation. So out of all of this came a number of opportunities. For me, it was to introduce all of these concepts of applied creativity, enterprise, and entrepreneurship, where these things are rarely discussed in a context specifically relevant to an individual. And that was the challenge that faced me talking to 20 plus PhD students. Why is this relevant to me? I'm in year three, you're in the middle of interrupting me as I gather data, and my supervisor's down my neck for a report or whatever. Why me? So I spent the early weeks very much in discussion mode with the group to tease out, what does it mean to be creative? What does it mean to apply creativity? Is it relevant to you? It took a number of weeks for it to gel and to work, but it did actually get there. I would say 90% of the students had two interesting children. I had one chappie who his PhD was in pure mathematics, and the notion of applying his work to anything was alien. And in fact, it would sully his work, the notion you could apply pure mathematics. So, we kind of agreed to disagree, and he worked his way through the process with me. But I'd say the degree to which I would have had, you know, changed his mind or maybe opened his mind to possibilities is probably fairly limited. the other individual, and I had this discussion with them, is one of the problems with working with students of this high caliber, I mean, to get a scholarship like this, you have to be sort of creme de la creme, is it's highly likely you've never failed. And for people who've never failed, discussing failure for starters can be an issue, but also recognizing that it's okay to fail can be a problem. So we had long discussions around failure and what does it mean in the context of being creative, from taking a chance and being calculated with your risk taking. I hopefully demonstrated the potential for the business school to, you know, play a key role in enterprise and entrepreneurship. But many of the discussions that I've had in fora like these over the past number of years, business schools are struggling to see where they fit. You know, there are so many people in business schools that are ingrained in the traditional approach that it's now hard for them to present themselves in the alternative. They're available to support, you know, with certain number of structures. Perhaps a more modern thinking in terms of what does it mean to do a lean startup? How can you apply a business model canvas to any aspect of people's work and people's thinking? One of the great things was students were able to share their own diverse perspectives on processes and challenges common to them as PhD students. It can be a lonely road for somebody doing a four-year PhD program. You tend to do most of your work on your own. And few opportunities are offered to you where you sit with people from other colleges and schools to share thoughts and perspectives. And it was interesting to watch the room as people would make a comment and say, God, I never thought of it like that. It's a whole new way of thinking. The folks from the College of Art down in Burren, they were kind of really intrigued at my terminology versus their terminology when it came to creativity. And we were kind of saying the same thing, but in different ways. And for the students to hear those two different perspectives, again, they said that was particularly useful in terms of opening their minds to possibilities. That first year weekend away in the Burren, what better place to kind of take away a cadre of PhD students to get them to bond? You know, local pub down in Ballyvaughan, what better spot? Imagine the following day, I don't think it was hugely productive by all accounts. But they did bond, and they kind of created, you know, their own web pages and things like that to stay connected. So to be able to come back again after 2 years and kind of share experiences, given that they probably haven't seen each other during those 2 years, was really useful for them. Because I think there is work to be done for particularly structured PhD students to provide them with those kind of supports, to help them realize you're not on your own, and it's not just you and your supervisor, you know, or your own school and college. There were challenges. Engaging them in third year, with hindsight, probably not the best time. It's too late. So we're moving forward into backwards into second year this year. So in actual fact, this year I will have second year and third year. So I've covered about 45. I haven't done anything else, I'm actually going to manage that. We figured that out over Christmas. But again, I like these opportunities, challenges. Their openness to alien terminology. Now, they would have regarded a lot of business terminology as alien, unless they happened to be doing their PhD in the School of Business and Economics. Particularly what it means to be entrepreneurial. That took quite a while to work through. Some of the definitions that we would have come up with over those areas were really useful in terms of kind of setting the scene with it and say, yeah, I know you don't like the term, but just step back for a minute and think about what does it actually mean to be an enterprising individual? What does it mean to be somebody who's creative and enterprising? And then somebody who takes it beyond that, has the passion to make something happen. So terminology like that, they slowly started to buy into. And in actual fact, a lot of the feedback from the humanities students was, we've left it until third year to start to think about this. We haven't thought at all about what we're doing when we graduate. We're just so focused on our research, and we haven't thought about the next step. So all of a sudden it started to get them thinking, I need a plan. Definitely not all were happy to take the module. They didn't like the fact that they had set times to turn up. They're very used to having their own schedule and timing to be able to plan. As I say, about 90% of them eventually said, yeah, look, I know why you're doing this. They recommended that I should have fewer sessions, longer, so I'm going to do that, so that'll help. Responding to their needs and opinions, again, I would have been always listening to what they're saying as regards, is this of value to me? Am I getting something out of this? Because if they're not, there's no point in wasting people's time. You know, people of this caliber, you know, need the opportunities available to them. But at the same time, I need to respect the fact that they need time to do other things. And then the students buy into selling their work. You know, the work of many research students is for them so important that it's the be all and end all for them for a period of time. Why do they need to sell it to anybody? I know what I'm good at. Now, that only works to a point. And you know, publications will demonstrate in an academic context how good you are. And you know, I have a track record in terms of writing papers and things like that. But if you're a PhD student that suddenly finds there are no opportunities in academia, and that you may need to think about industry or somewhere else in the public sector to go, then you're going to have to demonstrate who you are and what you've been doing and what you're good at. So it was important to get over that hurdle and to realize I need to be able to sell my work, but even more so, I've got to be able to sell it to people who don't understand my work. Yeah, that's a huge challenge because they want to talk for hours about it. My own daughter actually can't summarize the research that she's doing over in the Trinity Research Institute quickly enough that I don't lose interest in it. The whole sales pitch piece is so important. I guess that's where kind of business thinking kind of come in and really help. As I say, for the futures, I'm definitely going to move it into the second year, so it'll tie more closely with their first year module, and it will give them more time to apply the thinking in the years and get them better prepared for the final years of the degree program. I am incorporating changes recommended by students, and some of the existing or last year's cohort have actually offered to come in and sell the program to the next cadre to get me over that hump of convincing them this is worthwhile. So I don't have to spend 2 or 3 weeks working through that. But they're actually going to come back in and do the salary for me, which is great. I am hoping, I can't guarantee, but I'm hoping to have influenced our new strategic plan, which is on the verge of being published. Nobody ever knows what's in these strategic plans when they're published. You can make all the submissions you want, you can make all the demonstrations you want, but unless somebody at the senior level decides that it's important, it may not get there. But I'm hopeful. We did corner our president in Beijing for a photo opportunity, so every little helps, as they say. If you don't know, how am I doing for time, Amir?
Yeah. You're doing fine. You have another 5. You have 10 minutes.
Sorry, okay, good. These are some of the presentations made by a couple of these students. And Irish and Tanya would have been two individuals that would have been really challenged to get on board. They have opinions, and they're very vocal in being able to voice those opinions, and they were very persuasive in their opinions. So I knew I had a lot of work to do to buy them in. But by the end, they were two of the most strongest advocates of the program. So for me, that's good, positive feedback. So this is Ailisha's presentation on her research work. They just managed just over 3 minutes. Didn't quite make 3 minutes, but it's close.
Hi, my name is Ailisha Hill and I'm in the Department of Irish, and I've set myself the deceptively easy task of asking how we tell stories, and I'm particularly interested in traditionally Irish-speaking community in the West Kerry Gaelic of Corcaigne. The inhabitants of Corcaigne have had their stories told and retold throughout the world by filmmakers, by storytellers, by artists, to such an extent that they've now reached mythical proportions. So in 1996, when TG Cahir, the Irish language television station, was founded, this had offered the inhabitants of Corcaigne the opportunity to tell their own stories in their own terms of reference in this new, well, this contemporary media par excellence television. And in 1995, Brendan Verter, a broadcaster and a filmmaker and a native of Corcaigne, set out to capture on film the memories of the surviving members of the Blasket Island community. On the film, the first speaker, by way of introducing herself, Niamh Lelia tells us, Tomás O'Criffin, the famous writer, was my grandfather. And then she continues to perform a passage out of a letter that her mother, Leisha Hulvan, wrote to the English scholar, George Chambers. And now this letter, in the letter, Leisha Hulvan tells about the last time that she visited her family on the Blasket Islands. She had moved off and relocated to the mainland, and she went back to the Blaskets to visit her family. And in that last hour that she spent with them there, she explains how they laughed together, they cried together, and they drank tea together as well. And then, of course, it was him for her time to leave and to move back onto the mainland. Now, I recall this story here in English, but on the film, Lelia tells the story in Irish, as if she was reading a passage from the letter that her mother had written. But the letter, in fact, was written in English. So this shows us that Lelia has her own version, her own memory of that particular letter. And to further extend that story, we have also got her father's autobiography, Lord Barsale. And in this he tells us how it was his wife, the Queen, as he calls her, Leisha Hulvan, who wanted to move off to the mainland to offer her daughter further opportunity. and that for him, the husband, for Sean McGriffin, this was like a life sentence, having to move off and to leave his beautiful home on the island. So what we have in the Leah's performance then is her understanding that she has drawn and has been informed by the stories told to her by her mother, by those stories and testimonies written down by her mother, and by the stories told by her father and other members of the community and her family, of course, as well. So what Neely has done is allowed these different memories, these different informants and testimonies that she has heard or read, to come together, and she merges them into one coherent narrative that is uniquely her own. And it also gives us not only her unique understanding of her lived experience, but an understanding of a member of that traditionally Irish-speaking community in West Kerry and how one particular member of that community narrates her history. So what I am asking for then, and what I am proposing with my research, is I'm looking for a new understanding of storytelling in a traditionally Irish-speaking community, an understanding that shows storytelling as a cultural practice.
So, I'm just a great girl, actually. One of the things throughout the discussion I had with her was she started to think to herself, I'm really enjoying my research, but what am I going to do next? And I would have said to her, well, you may or may not be aware, but one of the key skills that is now required by chief executives and senior managers in the company is the ability to tell stories. To be effective at telling stories. So who better to act as a consultant to chief executives on how do you tell a good story? She may never do it, but if she now has piqued her interest that I can apply my work to many different strands of things if I open my mind to possibilities. So she's a very strong advocate now of the module, which is terrific for me. If I can bring up the other one, if you bear with me. So Tanya is doing her PhD in the School of Law, and Tanya would have been particularly vocal that this was going to take 20 minutes, and not less. But she actually turned out to be the star of the show in terms of presenting in just over 3 minutes. So it was interesting.
Hi, I'm Tanya. I'm a human rights lawyer with a background in international law and international politics, and my research project focuses on enforced disappearances. So imagine it's 3 in the morning and a half a dozen armed men storm into your house screaming, shouting, breaking into the door and looking for your son who's still asleep. He's 19 years old. They drag him out of bed in his sleeping clothes taken with them and assure you that they're going to bring him back as soon as possible. They just need to ask him some questions. You've never seen these men before, but based on their behavior, you assume that they somehow belong to governmental security forces. In the morning, you go to their office and you start inquiring about the whereabouts of your son, and everybody shows you, we have no idea where he is. We didn't arrest him, but of course, we will initiate investigations as soon as possible. Well, you wait for them to do something and you start your own investigations. Days become weeks become months become years, and you never hear about your son again. This practice became notorious in the context of the Latin American dictatorships in the 1970s and the 1980s. At this time, bereaved family members started to organize, and they created an influential international victims movement claiming for an international convention against enforced disappearances. This convention was successfully proclaimed in 2010. As you can see, most of the Latin American and South American states actually ratified the instrument, while most states in the Middle East and in Southeast Asia didn't ratify or sign the convention. Well, enforced disappearances is a global phenomenon. It occurs frequently in Africa, in the Middle East, and in Asia. We have frequent occurrences still in Central America, and we have even reported individual cases since war on terror started in Europe and in North America. So that the Asian states did not ratify the convention so far or not sign the convention so far does not mean that they're not interested in countering the problem, because they started initiatives against it on the national level, which might indicate an inclination towards codifying the international instruments as well. What my research has focused on are the historical origins in the Latin American context for the regime on enforced disappearances. And in a second step, I will look at Southeast Asia and at attitudes towards human rights in Southeast Asia. And I will try to assess if the international framework which was shaped in a particular context is applicable to a different context in another region of the world. And I will argue that the legal regime on enforced disappearances was developed to counter strategic security policy, organized security policy, which resulted in massive enforced disappearances. While in East, Southeast Asia, we basically have a breakdown of the rule of law. So we have a different political context. What I hope to achieve in my research are slight modifications and different interpretations that I can introduce in order to make the universal framework actually applicable in different regions. And I hope to support the work of national and international policymakers in their efforts to create effective preventative mechanisms against enforced disappearances in Southeast Asia. Thank you very much for your attention.
So, what did they just do?
They synthesized and succinctly demonstrated to laymen, to general audience.
And I would argue they also sold it. It made it interesting. People got it. What's the business pitch about? Exactly the same thing. So now they have taken some of the types of thinking and approach that we would normally associate with just business practice into their research. And they have now for life. The two girls are terrific in terms of presenting and will go on and will surely be very successful in their areas. But there are examples of all of the others. There's another one there as well. But they all had to make that effort to make those presentations, and they all felt it was extremely worthwhile to understand some of the things that we talk about in a business context, or in, you know, when we talk about entrepreneurship, but how they transcend if you just open your mind to possibilities. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that, Michael. Okay. Any questions from Michael?
Thanks, Michael. That was excellent. Can I just ask you, what did you say to them to get them at that level of they communicated so succinctly?
I challenged them. I told them to make every word count, to strip it back to the bone, and what is the essence of what your research is about? It's the core piece of research. And by all means, then, if you want to add little bits and pieces to, you know, flex it out a bit, fine, but what's the core? And that's really helpful for them because they're at a stage where they need to feel, and I really got this from them, they need to feel like the work that they're doing is of value because they're starting to question their journey. They're third year of a structured PhD program, and a lot of people who work, you know, their colleagues and whatever are already out working and doing something, and they're starting to feel left behind. One girl I didn't show you that's in the IT sphere, she's under pressure from family and friends to commercialize her work before she finishes. And don't finish the PhD, just go and commercialize. So she's under that type of pressure. So even having the discussion of that with other people in the room who weren't from IT was very helpful for her.
Yeah, I mean, you could see careers within the media, right, like that, with the way they presented it, yeah.
And it's quite possible that Irish will actually do something to teaching Carol, she's a fluent Irish speaker.
I think it's interesting that young PhD students, you mentioned the staff were really difficult to work with and hadn't really thought about the career aspirations. Will we actually translate that to all undergraduates? So
absolutely.
Often don't know what they're going to be able to do and finish it.
That's right.
Think about it encouraging.
That's right. Which is why what we talk about here is so applicable to every student. It's why I mentioned societies earlier as a way of getting to them if, you know, it's not part of their core curriculum. Giving them opportunities to enter competitions. The Students' Union in NUI Galway, you know, is very proactive in terms of supporting entrepreneurial activity, whether it's competitions or supporting them with funding. The VP for Innovation has a pot that he makes available where academic staff can collaborate with students if they have a common idea that they want to push forward. There's a fund made available to do that as well. So I'm hopeful that all of those things will be joined up under the strategic plan in the next little while. Yes, sir.
If I could just comment, you were talking earlier about failure, and as well people mentioned that. Just in case of any relevance, my take on that is it almost starts with a realization that business plans fundamentally, I think, come from big business thinking. Most business professionals, excuse me, really fundamentally learn about business from a big business perspective. They may intellectually know small businesses are not small, big businesses. But nevertheless, I think the word business triggers business thinking.
Yeah.
So I tend to call them new ventures rather than small businesses because it avoids that word. And once you start thinking like that, you realize, I think that they have much more in common with explorers than with big businesses. And once you talk about exploration, I think you start to realize that it's very unlikely the first thing you try is going to be the best way to do it. And totally even oil explorers still expect to have to drill up to 10 wells to find one productive one. So finding an unproductive one is not a failure, it's part of the route to success. But almost because we've made it a separate venture for a business plan we have, it then doesn't work, we call it a failure. So I wonder if we actually call it things failures that are merely not actually failures, that are part of the inevitable non-direct line to success.
So stepping stones.
That you have to expect if you're going to explore. Yes. And then it's we stop having to, you don't have to deal with failure, because it isn't failure, it's what you expect to happen occasionally.
I totally agree with you. I suppose from a cultural point of view, we have a lot of work to do in this country to get to that point. But people think that's why. Hopefully we're getting there.
So I'm trying to avoid the word and say, if you call it failure, then we want people frightened of it. Look at it as failure. Until Edison, his assistant said, yeah, after exploring a lot of substances to make a light bulb filament and they weren't working, he said, we're failing. He said, no, we just found out. We now know 100 things that don't work. We're making progress. We can put those on one side and concentrate on the rest. So he saw it as part of the what they had to go through.
Was this in the programme from the start? And if not, what was taken out to give the space? I mean, there's certainly so many credits to the structure PhD Junior does. So was this, how did you get it in there in the first place?
Well, I had the dean coming to me saying, I have 5 credits to do this. So she initiated it.
Okay.
I didn't have to go hunting for this one. I just grabbed the opportunity.
I was going to say, if I don't know how the university system works in the structured PhDs, but if there's another program where there isn't this already in there, it's going to be difficult because you've got to take something out of the program.
It is possible to extend it beyond these 2 scholarship PhD programs. There may be challenges. Okay. There is that possibility, but it's been specifically asked for these 2 scholarships.
Okay. I think it's great that you've done. For me, as a creative, sometimes part of the engineer comes out of you, part engineer, part creator, designer, or whatever. And sometimes engineer comes out in education and says, maybe I should be too creative. And I said, I bring first year students sometimes to do work on environment. These are design students, they should be creative, and they kind of I'm sure what it's saying about puppets and all those things. And it's hard to drag them out. Admirable for bringing PhD students down. But I'd say, how did you actually overcome, how did you explain to them what the purpose of it was? How did you move them around?
A lot of it was listening to them and trying to listen to what was important to them, not making any assumptions about it. In some ways, going through a kind of a customer validation process myself, that I walked in with a prototype that didn't have a lot of bones on it, but that gave me the potential to flex it based on what they said was important to them.
And do you get a lot of reflection at that stage, just kind of turn into a group hugging?
There was actually quite a bit of that at the start. Yeah, it was.
Because
giving people an opportunity to talk.
The only value I got in engineering was the PhD was actually meeting other people. but it's such an instant process. It's yeah. Only process that the only opportunity you get to talk to them is just
Certainly people from, you know, from the School of Engineering and talking to people from the humanities with totally different perspectives on how their PhD has been structured, who they've been working with, how it's been going, is invaluable for them. And for many of them to realise they're all pretty much at the same stage. It's comforting.
But I think that, that's a really valuable exercise in being the same industry. So
And I knew going in they were not 2 and 5 year olds.
The perpetual culture method of quickly without any words and just having images is really important as well. Actually saw a clip recently that trying to get people to do interpretive dance in their PhD.
And it's always hard not to take the post-lunch session when people are bellies full and their whole body is focused on processing food, nice TCU food. So, you know, Michael referred to, you know, dealing with students who were, you know, very much at the top of their game, very studious, I suppose, might have always had an academic career in mind, and so on. But earlier on, we also spoke about the fact that some of what we want to achieve in terms of students' education can actually be done outside the classroom and outside of the curriculum. And that's a programme that both Mike and I are involved with already, and there's nobody else left in the room with Stephen, which we have somebody here earlier on today. Peter from Olympus was here earlier on. The Enactus competition, or I'll let you start setting up again. The Enactus competition is an international social entrepreneurship competition that's been running since the 70s internationally. And when it came to this stage and KPMG were involved in setting it up, I was took it by the scruff of the neck here in DCU because I thought it was an amazing learning opportunity for the students. And it's been running in Ireland for 3 years now, and Laura Denny is the country manager for Enactus Ireland. And I asked her to come along to speak to you about the competition, explain the competition, but more importantly, to explain what the feedback is that they get. The model of the competition, as she will explain, involves close collaboration between business advisors and students themselves. So we're working on this as a student society essentially. And she's done some interesting research on the feedback that they get from these business people who are actually looking at these students as potential employees. So there's an element there of that. And I asked her to come along and speak to us about that because it just gives us an extracurricular version of what we've been speaking about. So Laura, thanks a million for coming along.
Thank you. So, as Emer said, my name is Laura Denny, and I'm country manager for an organisation called Enactus Ireland. And I'm going to start by giving you a brief introduction to what Enactus is, and I'm going to focus more on the prospective employer's view of social entrepreneurship, and particularly social entrepreneurship in an on-campus setting. And just to begin with, I just want to give you a little bit of information about myself. I'm a UCC graduate. I graduated in 2004, and I immediately started working for FROIGA, the National Youth Development Organisation, which you may have heard of. I worked for FROIGA for 8 years in a number of different roles, mainly with young offenders. So interesting now that I spend all my time with students. There are a few differences, but a few similarities between the groups as well. 2 years ago, I started working for Enactus. I suppose my main motivation for taking up this role is I have a real passion for youth development, and that has been my entire career to date. I've been working hand in hand with young people addressing their needs, but really being on a journey with them. And I continue to be able to do that now with Enactus. But that combined with education. Many of the young people I worked with Broga had access to education but didn't engage with it. And now I get to work with students who are very privileged, who are engaging with their education and who are developing themselves as a result. So what I'm going to talk about here today is, just as I said, a brief introduction to my organisation. I'm going to move on to looking at what is social entrepreneurship. I am certainly not the expert in this area. I am learning as I go. So please stop me if you have any comments or questions. I'm going to move on then to think about it from an employer's perspective. So what do they think that social entrepreneurship is? What do they want when they're looking at hires, new hires and graduates? I'm going to look at what role faculty advisors and academic and non-academic staff on university campuses play with working with social entrepreneurship and student development. I'm going to take a brief look at the graduate recruitment system, which is interesting, kind of follows up a bit with what Michael was saying about being able to express your knowledge and your experience. And I'm going to give you some feedback directly from our advisors, our business advisors who've worked hand in hand with some of our students. So to begin looking at what Enactus is, Enactus, Emer mentioned we have a competition, but in fact we're an entire program. And we use the medium of social enterprise as a process, a way for students to experience a new opportunity, but to engage in a skills development and leadership development program. They do this by looking in their local communities, identifying problems, social issues, and addressing them using business models or a different creative approach. Some of our students go on to create sustainable social enterprises, but that's actually not our end goal. Our end goal is the students themselves and their own development. We have this incredible byproduct of our students impacting local communities in a really fantastic way. Enactus Ireland is part of a global organisation, and we have a franchise agreement with the head office in the United States. And we're actually part of this network of 36 countries, which is amazing because we're the newest country. We're only 3 years old. There's 6 or 7 years between our entry into the network and the last country. So we have a great opportunity to learn from those around us. So there are 36 countries. There are over 1,600 university programs with 67,500 students participating across the world. Really fascinating for our students to be engaging in the network, not only in Ireland, but internationally as well. So just quickly looking at Ireland. So at the moment, Enactus has 8 HEI partners. So we're in 7 universities and DIT. What we're focusing at the moment is developing a really strong program that our students can benefit from, and then we will look at rolling out our program further. We are funded purely from the corporate sector. We don't have any government funding at the moment. And here are our partners. Emer mentioned one of the motivations for our partners engaging with us. And one of the motivations is student recruitment. Maybe not today, but they might want to recruit the students in 5 or 10 years' time. So a lot of it is about brand prominence, brand awareness as well. Many of our partners are extremely focused on having really strong corporate social responsibility portfolios. And working with our students enable that. We also have a really strong employee engagement program, which I'm going to talk about in a minute again. So for these reasons, our partners are incredibly active and work hand in hand with our students. So if Enactus is more than an entrepreneurship, social entrepreneurship competition, we have an entire process. So we start by setting up student teams on campus. The teams are student-led, but the students are supported by faculty advisors and Enactus champions on campus, who are really, really essential people, two who are sitting in the room with us today, Mira and Michael, and really essential to making sure that the teams work, function year on year. Sustainability is always an issue for doing student-led projects on campus, particularly setting up new things. And the teams are then supported by the National Office, which is myself and my colleague, Liam Redmond. Liam is our program manager, and he is a DCU graduate and former Enactus student here in DCU, and he was in EMRIS class as well. So we hire our own students as well as expecting our partners to hire them too. We get the best ones. So the National Office provides training, support and guidance for the students as they develop their projects. Most of the training is provided by our partners, our business partners, our corporate partners, but also other experts in the fields of entrepreneurship. So we work closely with the likes of Ashoka, Social Entrepreneurs Ireland, as well, to be able to deliver really, really quality training to the students. We go beyond the training, looking at social entrepreneurship, but we go beyond that into looking at their careers as well. So we do a lot of work on building your CV, preparing for interviews, a lot of other things that they can apply to other aspects of their college career and their own career. They're also supported and guided by business advisors as well as their faculty advisors. So each team, each Enactus team, has a team of business advisors who mentor and guide them throughout the process and are actively helping them develop their projects. So the difference with Enactus and maybe some other things that happen on campus is that our students have to implement their projects. They have to go beyond the theory. It can't be a business plan. And we actually don't really encourage business plans. We do use the business model canvas quite a lot so that they can continue to change and innovate and overcome failure or maybe just, you know, that longer route to success that we were talking about earlier. And then we have competition. So competition is great just to get people motivated, but it also is an opportunity for students to showcase what they've done in their best practice. On the day of the competition, we always say it might necessarily be the team that comes first that wins. It can be the students who walk out with the job of their dreams, the summer internship, the connections that they want in 5 years' time when they want to develop their career further. Or equally, the connections with other universities. We have students who meet faculty advisors and then go do their master's in another university or another HEI as well. So who wins is always a nice conversation. Just looking briefly at what I would see social entrepreneurship as being. And again, similarly to Michael, I see it as being a process. So developing and implementing sustainable, innovative solutions to overcome problems. So from what do employers think of this? And I think one thing that is quite interesting, why are employers interested in entrepreneurship in the first place, or in social entrepreneurship in the first place? I mean, there's lots of things that happen on campus. There's lots of different opportunities for students to get involved in. Where do employers see this sitting or the purpose of this? And I suppose there's a couple of different ways that we can look at this. And I have just some suggestions here. Employers love the idea of students practically applying what they're learning in university or in college. The idea that during a 3 or 4 year degree, we have the opportunity to be exposed to a lot of different skills, abilities, theories, but to be able to practically use them during that time as well enhances the learning. I know a student of Dr. Magella Giblin in Trinity came to me and said, but to fish out all Magella's notes from last year because I need them now for my next project. She couldn't really remember them at the time, so she was now practically applying them. The idea of being able to develop skills and different abilities that students might have by applying those projects, being involved in actively delivering a social enterprise or actively setting it up is of interest to employers. Gaining a greater understanding of the world. So when I say this, I don't mean just the world of work, but employers are interested, they want to know what students think about maybe the world of politics, society at large, and we really challenge the students, and not only in Enactus, but in social enterprise in general, we challenge the students to step outside of that safe comfort zone that is the campus, that is the HEI campus, which is lovely to stay with, and there's lots of challenges happening there as well. But we want students to look beyond that, and employers really appreciate that understanding, making a positive impact on our society, and a focus on action leaders. So going beyond the conversations, which are really, really important as well, but going beyond them into the doing. Employers see that as really important.
One of the things that employers like about social entrepreneurship and entrepreneurship in general on campus is the fact that it is open to everyone. A program like an Actus, or maybe getting involved with something like Ashoka, you don't have to be in the business campus. You don't have to be in the business school. I might have referred to this earlier as well, and it's really essential because I think traditionally that's where social enterprise and entrepreneurship fell. And you can see, actually, it's just a lovely picture. You might recognize some of your students there, Michael, and Emer, some of yours are there as well. Some DIT students and CD ones there too, and Maluth. So, traditionally in Actus, we do have the largest number of our students coming from the business school still. First year was much more. This is the third year, and we're at 57%, and 41% of computer science, and then way up. When we say business related, so that is any degree that somebody has business as part of it. So it includes marketing and management, finance, accounting, a whole array of things. But still, the majority of students taking part in our program are from that sort of academic area. You see, humanities are the next biggest, and that probably comes maybe from UCT or DCU that they're bringing up the numbers there a bit. But employers really do like the idea that when they come to meet a group of students involved in social enterprise, they can be from anywhere. They're not just meeting business students. One of the reasons they like this is because now, unfortunately, it doesn't matter what your degree is, they want you to have the skills and abilities that come with this sort of experience. I'm going to look at that again in a minute. Actually, one interesting thing about students in this kind of light is one of our students, Claire from Maynooth, which maybe some of you know. Claire is just finished a degree in English and Geography. And she came to me once and she was saying how frustrating it was because all her colleagues in college who were studying business, they were producing work, getting academic credits for it that she's doing at the weekends for fun. She's actually now doing a master's in business. But this was her passion, and she was doing this at the weekends. She was working her own business model campus while her friends were complaining that they had to go through a session of it during college. So just to focus in more on what employers want, and from my experience, unfortunately maybe for students at the moment, but now employers want everything. Maybe traditionally there was a big focus on the first class honours set of students. Now they want that and more. So what do they want? They want the academic achievement. They want the broad skill base. They want the ability to interview well. If they can't interview well, if they can't prove it in that 20 minutes in front of them, they're not going to give somebody a chance. They want current ability. So they want you to be able to demonstrate what you can do right now, but they also want to be able to see that you have a future potential. These are just two quotes from graduate recruiters. So they need to be able to distinguish themselves from the rest. And the ideal candidate actually evaluates the employer as well as being evaluated themselves. And I think about that statement, and I think about a 24-year-old me, 23, 24-year-old me leaving college. I certainly was not able to evaluate the people who were interviewing me. I was lucky if I was able to get through the interview at all. I think that's so challenging for graduates to be leaving with their degree knowing or maybe not knowing that this is what is expected of them. So looking further at the skills and abilities, this is kind of an array of skills and abilities that we try to, look at as part of the Enactus program, and generally people would in social enterprise across the board. The ones that stand out really for me would be resilience, goal setting, the leadership, teamwork. And I suppose if you take a look at these skills, do any of these stand out as skills or abilities that students that you work with might be lacking in or mightn't even be aware that they need it? Be interested to know if what I've identified would be similar to what you would identify.
Certainly one that I experienced in the process was running meetings.
Okay.
And we talked about that, and we put a program in place and to help them run meetings. Mm-hmm.
We didn't have to take minutes, we didn't want to chair. The process of running a meeting had never gone through it. So this is a terrific opportunity for them to learn.
And Michael, that's really an interesting one because I was sort of, I was horrified that this wasn't happening properly. But of course, how could it possibly? Nobody had shown them before. Or maybe they had read it in a module, or but they'd never reflected on it properly or realised or understood what kind of tools they needed to be able to do this. I was quickly less horrified and more disgusted with myself that we hadn't preempted that this would have been an issue. Any other skills that people might see here that your students might struggle with? If this is what employers are expecting.
I think one general comment would be that some of the skills there, certainly from my perspective, I would have assumed that most of our students were engaged in clubs and societies.
Mm-hmm.
We actually reviewed them a couple of years ago in the engineering side again, and it was less than 5%
mm-hmm.
actually admitted to being in any club or society where they would be in meetings and had communication skills. So, and they're not learning from there, so I think it's a lot of those that we presume they had somewhere.
And you're correct, there are many different programs on campus that students can engage with, not simply just our program, but maybe they're not, and maybe it is a very small number who are accessing these.
Very useful. I'm just thinking that generally the students, I don't think they think in terms of their skills, they think in terms of the next assignment and next exam, and what have we got to do to pass.
Mm-hmm.
Last year I was teaching presentation skills for a final year group. And the content was quite nice and interesting. But in one particular class, the three groups and a small group of teaching seminar situation, one group were absolutely excellent. They were just, they presented the level of masters in terms of the standard. The other two groups were really bad, right?
Yeah.
So I took an issue, I said to the good group, I said, guys, do you want to we'll finish up here with these two groups? So the good group left. I had a chat with them and I said, look, guys, you know, what's the problem here? What's the issue in terms of your presentation skills? And they're like, well, Alma, we thought it was grand. And it wasn't until I said that if an employer in the room, who would they have employed? And it was then that they got it, you know. So I don't think students think in terms of skills, and we need to teach them, or not teach them, but find out this more.
I think that's a really good point, because it's not even just the skills part, it's about giving them the opportunity to reflect on their skill levels. And that's actually something I'm going to talk about again in a minute at interview stage, because that's so essential to be able to have an understanding of where you're at when you're being interviewed.
I think it might be interesting to look at in terms of rather what the employers want is what can the student give to them that's a valid value. So for example, portfolios we do assign that shows the employer the possibilities of what the student can do. And I was just saying to some of the guys over lunch that worked in design for years, and it's literally like you sit at a desk and you come up with your own ideas and you think you know what somebody wants.
Mm-hmm.
However, I always thought it might be a lot more interesting, a lot more relevant if you actually got up off your backside and went out and saw what people actually did.
Mm-hmm.
So if that was a kind of a skill that if I was saying to design students, tell that to an employer, give them options. Like show them the breadth of research that you can do rather than what they want. Does that make sense?
Yeah, no, it absolutely does. And in fact, I think that comes back to one of the comments from one of my CEOs about evaluating the employer. When you go for your interview,
yeah.
It is about showcasing what you're best at and not going through this list going, God, I'm going to be terrible at these things. I just find it fascinating that when you ask employers what they're looking for, recruiters what they're looking for, they might mention five top things, you know, like the communication piece, the interpersonal piece, the organizational piece, the meeting deadlines piece. But when you go through it, then they really want so much more.
Yeah.
Again, it's quite a lot of pressure on the students, but I think allowing them the opportunity to reflect on where they're at and what they can bring to it. Nobody can bring all of those. And
that's
certainly not it when you graduate.
There was an employee survey there, I think, last year, which looked at this, and entrepreneurial skills was way down the bottom. But what was above was all the things that we, I think, associate with entrepreneurial skills, but it's not entrepreneurship. So
Yeah. There
was that language again in terms of what they think it means and what we think.
And actually, really interesting, Michael and I were discussing this briefly just during lunch there. There is a question as to whether or not employers want to hire entrepreneurs. And often they actually don't. They want the entrepreneurial skills. They want all the other things that they can slot into that, because they want staff that are going to train and be loyal and be creative and be problem solvers within their own company, rather than setting up their own business on the side, leaving early so they can get in, do that, doing the 2 years so they can have a reference and setting up their own business. So there is the idea of the entrepreneur versus the intrapreneur and what ideally people want. But you're so right, the entrepreneurial skills and entrepreneurial spirit kind of is a cross-section of many of these different skills.
Sort of a can-do, will-do attitude.
Mm-hmm. And that really creative piece, which is interesting from your talk as well, Michael, that they really want people to be looking creatively and differently at things, and not just producing the same things again and again. And briefly, I've included, just back to Enactus again, but this can happen in other aspects of clubs and societies on campus as well, is the role of what we call Enactus faculty advisors. So the role of academic and non-academic staff on campus supporting students. And we get massively positive feedback from employers about this, particularly because maybe they draw attention to the fact of the reflective thinking side, or they're identifying the skills that students, such as the presentation skills, need to enhance while they are undergraduates. We find that working with our faculty advisors, they're really working hand in hand with students. They get to know them very well beyond that teaching-learning relationship, where they can really learn so much more about the needs of the student, and they are addressing it. Our faculty advisors are working really closely with our students to do that. Okay, so the graduate recruitment side, we're just going to touch briefly on. Again, these are two more quotes from, these are from CEOs that I work with. The idea that it's not just about having the experience, it's about being able to explain and express that experience. So interestingly, one of our partners who recruits across Ireland and the UK was speaking at a meeting we held about this time 12 months ago. We held a top-to-top forum with leaders of education, meeting with leaders in business. And they discussed graduate recruitment, or as we reframed the discussion throughout, as we were discussing it, we moved away from what the employers want to what the student wants, which was an interesting discussion in itself. But this CEO spoke about her experience of recruiting in Ireland and the UK. And she said that in the UK, the UK students go further in the recruitment in their recruitment process than the Irish students do, because they are better able to reflect upon their experiences and express it during interviews. So it's all well and good us giving our students lots of opportunities to develop new skills, have new experiences, get involved in social enterprise. If they cannot express that during the interview, we're back to a problem, because all the interviews are tick boxes and scoring along the side. And if our students can't do that, then they have an issue again. And similarly here, another now retired CEO said that communication skills and confidence are so important. And sometimes our students are really, really great communicators, and sometimes we forget that they need to be able to frame that within the interview space. I'm looking at this in the framework of the behavioural interview, which is what quite a lot of our partners use as an interviewing technique. Have you guys come across this before? Are you familiar with it? So it's really where, I suppose the reasons why they use this technique is because, you know, there's research done on this, but they say that it can predict, that past experience can predict whether or not somebody in future can produce the goods as an employee. So rather than asking somebody what are their skills, they're asking them to describe their skills. So anybody can walk into a room and say, I'm great at people and good at teamwork, whereas they're asking you to think about a situation, a task, what was the action and what were the results. So when they say, talk to me about your skills, they actually want the answer going, I'm a really strong leader. I was captain of the football team, we got relegated, but I kept our team together, and the following year we achieved great results and we got back into the Premier League or whatever. And that is what employers really need to see at the interview stage. anybody can walk in and say what they're good at. We can just Google what do employers want and then say that we have those skills, but about demonstrating what the actual skills are. So it calls for real life experience, moving beyond the hypothetical. And there's quite a few of these different techniques out there. There's Pro, Star, Sora. And actually, it can be really helpful for students to use these in advance of an interview. Even if the interviewer isn't using this technique, that they are thinking about their skills in relation to their experience rather than the hypothetical. I just included some additional quotes, because my employers give me some great, or my partners give me some great nuggets of experience and information. And I just wanted you to have a quick look at these. And I think time-wise, I might probably over a little bit. But I was wondering, in your experience and in your opinion, do any of these quotes from employers surprise you as to what they're looking at from graduates? Or is this what you would typically expect?
My own case ties in with what Almar said earlier on. Did you think you did a good presentation? Yes, I did. It was an employer in the room.
Oh. I was amazed at it.
It's just, I'm going to use that line Monday morning.
I'm
not getting through to someone for all my talk in here.
Students were quite aggressive with me. They couldn't believe. I think they just wanted me to give 40% grant, let's move on, what's the next thing I've got to do, the next essay or whatever. They didn't believe that they were as bad as they were, and they thought they could just go through the motions, right?
Yeah.
And so this three words, there's an employer in the room, who would they employ, right? Of the three groups. And then I said, okay, of the excellent group, who would the employer have employed? And actually, the employer would have had a tough job that day. But the message got home fairly quickly, I still use it now.
Yeah. It was great that you had those three groups together.
Now, I actually got pulled up with one student's email to me and said, well, that wasn't acceptable for you to ask one group to leave early to keep us behind. There was still 20 minutes left in the class. And I was very pleasant about it. Mm-hmm. I said, this is business, guys. You know, this is how the world works. But the message did get home. But I even had problems with asking one group to leave, and the other two were quite annoyed they were asked to stay behind. But they weren't asked to stay behind because we still had 20 minutes of class left.
Mm-hmm. Interesting.
The whole thing about hitting deadlines and teamwork and so on, I find that, you know, even when they're working on teamwork, you know, the report comes in and it's obvious, oh no, that's a bit Jimmy road. Now I'm obviously reading the bit Mary wrote, because Jimmy and Mary wrote their bits and they put together. Put them in, and that they don't realise that a teamwork is about a unified approach. It's about producing a report where it's so seamless you don't know who wrote which bit, because that's not material to it, it's that the team wrote it, and so on. So I do find that they struggle with teamwork, and not just the fair allocation of the work, but actually pulling everything together as a full team.
I think part of the work can be the actual design of the work that's given to them, because a lot of the times they can operate as a group. They don't need to function as a team. So they don't need to be that integrated.
Yeah.
They can carve it up and say, you do that, you do that, you do that, and pull it all together at the end and we function as a group.
Yeah.
Whereas,
but I think they don't want to actually be a team. Yeah. I think they probably get nervous that their good work might be overshadowed by somebody's not as good work.
I find as well the information beyond the degree. I put up a map of the European Union the other day to final year undergrad students, and they couldn't tell me the name of the country that we called Finland. To me that was shocking. I just lost it at that stage. I had another map up where Switzerland was white and it's not the European Union. What country is that? So the information beyond the degree I find very, very good.
Well, that's kind of the function of the leaving cert, where now you can't do geography if you want to do a science subject, because there's not enough opportunities available. My own daughter couldn't do history and geography because she wanted to do chemistry.
I just feel like civics are like engaging with the world at all. Very often they don't engage, they're living in a cocoon, but not engaging with anything. I say, did you hear the news this morning that, and I said, some big news item? No. And this is afternoon, so you'd expect.
We can tell you what's happening on Facebook.
And that's why, you know, with the Enactus competition, is you're forcing them to engage with the problems of the world by asking them to work on projects that they work on with Enactus.
So how does it actually work? Let's say, if we're DKT, we haven't got this, but we were interested in taking it to the next step. Do companies come in? Do you just give them a project?
So I suppose, firstly, we were at 8 at the moment, and because of resources, we're not rolling out the programme for the rest of this year anywhere else. And I know DKT really well. I've been out to you a couple of times. How it actually works, how Enactus works, is that it is student-led. So we bring them through quite a lot of training. Each campus gets 2 on-campus training events a year, and there's 3 national training events. So our first national training event this year happened on the 12th of November, and students met with not-for-profits and charities. We did a charity hack for idea generation. They met with businesses for project development and the projects that they were bringing on from last year. But they need to come up with the ideas themselves. We support them in that. Sometimes we highlight or showcase social issues for them by inviting people and speakers in to meet with them, such as a charity hack. But it has to come from the students who want to make a difference in that social issue. And really what I encourage our students to do is they need to be passionate about what they're doing. They need to feel something, they need to feel a connection, not just, oh, this problem of water charges, let's look at an engineering project that reduces water because that sounds like it could win a competition. They actually have to emotionally connect with what they're doing, because our students, unfortunately, in the majority of places, don't get academic credits for what they do. Across the world, in other countries, they do, depending on the country and the institution, but in Ireland, our students don't. So this is all additional to their essays, their exams. Our students are very quiet at the moment because a lot of them are at exams, and we have to respect that. But it's all their own work, and we provide the infrastructure, the tools, the support from people like Ian and Michael, who give up an awful lot of their time, and Janetta give up an awful lot of their time to support the students. But it is on their own time, and the business leaders as well, who I'm actually coming back to in a second. They would support the students. We don't provide a bursary. They need to be entrepreneurial in their approach and find their own funding, which is works out well in Galway and as well in some other places. But that's really the structure of it. Very much student-led, supported on campus by faculty, supported by us in business.
Can you give an example of a project that a student or a group in Ireland did?
Okay, well, I suppose possibly the best-known project would be Food Cloud. Have you heard of Food Cloud? Food Cloud is a project of Enactus Trinity College Dublin. They now have an entire company where they employ 6 people, so it is really a more successful, sustainable project. The students in Food Cloud identified that there's massive food waste and there's also huge food poverty across the world. They developed an app which connects restaurants and shops that have food waste with charities that need food. And it happens all through an app. People sign up and the food moves. And they've moved something like 200,000 tons of food this year. Their main partner is Tesco. They're sort of incredible. I think a nice example is an example from here, and from my employee, Liam Redmond. So Liam set up a social enterprise called Head Starts. Perhaps maybe some of you have heard of Head Starts. Head Starts is it's a program for people with intellectual disabilities, and it uses creative arts as a developmental tool. So it allows people from, I think it's about 16 now, is it even right?
Is there over 20 in it at the moment?
It's at the age of 16, so it's like...
Yeah, 16, but it's up to, you know, some of them might be their 40s or 50s, it's intellectual disabilities, so Down syndrome and other disabilities like that.
And do you want to continue?
Yeah, basically, Liam, it was his final year project. We encouraged the students that in addition to working on a business plan or an enterprise startup that could be potentially for profit, they can do a social enterprise. And he came in and he said, I have this idea. I volunteer at my local Special Olympics down in County Wicklow, but I can't stand sports, but I love dealing with these people. And I'd like to do basically the arts for people with intellectual disabilities. And I do this as my project. And I said, yes, you can, because but as long as you develop some kind of a sustainable model. So it actually, you know, these people pay, I mean, it's a small scale in terms of funding, but the head startists, as he calls the intellectually disabled people, pay a fiver each Tuesday night during the semester time to come onto campus, and there's three rooms near each other in one of the buildings, you know, the arts building, essentially, the humanities building, and they can do drama or music or visual art for the first hour, and then drama or music or visual art, vice versa, for the second hour. And it's very much a social outlet for these people. It's very much confidence building, and so on. It's their club, they take huge ownership of it. You can see these people with intellectual disabilities, some of them even, you know, actually blind or dumb as well, you know, with multiple disabilities. But they very much feel like a club, they feel like it's their community, it's their social outlet. One girl, you know, goes into the pits of depression from Wednesday morning until the following Tuesday afternoon when she's back there. It's run entirely by the students, and they at one stage had more student volunteers than people with intellectual disabilities. They had over 20 people with intellectual disabilities coming in off campus. But Liam developed that on his own with guidance at the background from me and then from the whole practice program. But he literally had to go out and convince people in places like St. Michael's House to bring their charges, let's say, in. Most of the people can't actually travel on their own. They're brought in a minibus, or they're brought in the carer's car, or whatever. One or two kind of buses on their own. So the students love helping and running these workshops, and they organised. They had, last night was their, or Wednesday night was their end of the show in Santa Cane and so on. So that's basically been running on the campus for the last, this is the third year.
The sky's the limit really in terms of projects. So once it fits certain criteria that would be set by an artist, then any project is valid. One of the ones that I came across a number of years ago, I'm sure you remember it, one day the word fun was an American university that collaborated with a local prison to recycle mattresses. And off the back of it, they ultimately set up a company to hire ex-cons to do the work, to help them rehabilitate back into mainstream life again. So they were ticking so many boxes for that particular project. And I think they went down to lower that national.
Yeah. They signed a contract with the US Navy to get 16,000 mattresses on an annual basis. It's just wonderfully sustainable. DIT have a lovely project last year called Michael Women's Group, where in Malawi they set up microfinancing and a savings group for a local women's group there. So we do encourage the students to look locally first. But they are allowed to undertake a global project if they can prove that they have the knowledge and expertise to do so.
Can I just add to what you're doing there? Just going back to the earlier question around how people get involved, unfortunately the ITs, with the exception of DIT, can't get involved in an ACTUS yet because there is a resource challenge, you working across a lot of AGIs. But there is another initiative through SEAM, and it's working very closely with Laura, whereby students from five HEIs have worked together to develop a network of student enterprise societies. And they're doing a really exciting project, student-led entrepreneurial activities on campus. And they've been working together, they're looking to expand it. So if there's any, and eventually we hope that we'll be able to align
join
what we're doing. This is why we're having a very close relationship with Laura. We're sort of preparing them so that when the opportunity does arise down the way, that we'll be ready to
start transition.
Absolutely. But in the meantime, we're using your skills and expertise in this area. But you know, the value and the strength of student-led enterprise is really important, and it gives them an opportunity to put in practice what they're doing in the classroom, but in a safe environment, but also with a huge student marketplace as well. So if there's any students or any academics or educators interested in developing a network at their HEI, just let us know. We can put you in touch with that student network.
And I'm more than happy to speak about it. I speak to student groups about employability, about skills development, about social enterprise.
like a, as a side to an Aptus as well. So if it is something that would help promote such activities on your campus, I'd be delighted to help. Just the only thing that I like about my favourite one about this is that employers actually want students to have a knowledge of social and ethical work, and I was very relieved and pleased to see that when it came out in our research. And I'm just going to show one more slide. So I mentioned business advisors already. So business advisors help advise, mentor, and work really, really closely with the students. And I think they're able to give that feedback. Almer, that you were speaking about, but it can be difficult to give your students that feedback. Would an employer do it? Or business advisor do it very effectively and efficiently, say, well, no, this is terrible, or that's not going to work, or what are you going to do about this? And they work hand in hand with the students. So we would survey them twice a year to see their experience with new student groups, ask them to give us their initial observations. And among them, they described, among the student groups, poor communication, poor planning organisation, a lack of resilience, poor relationship management, not willing to take advice, lack of knowledge of the business world. So that was all pretty damning.
They were all right.
This is across the board. This is not attributed to anyone in the Aptus team. But I'll give my closing remarks. So, after working with you for a period of time, they said they're ambitious, driven, and hardworking. They have strong interpersonal communication skills, much improved organisation skills. We've still got a way to go on that one. Able to develop and manage relationships, which is really, really tough and challenging in any sector. Open to constructive criticism, better presentation skills, grounded and realistic, a clear understanding of the business world. So I suppose just to finish, what I presented sounds like we require so much from our students that it's almost an impossible task. I really wanted to give you a snapshot of how challenging it is out there for students. It doesn't mean that our students suddenly have to become experts in everything, or they need to. I really like your comment of that we have to kind of enable them to showcase what they're really good at and bring that forward.
Especially Irish students.
And allowing them, as you said, Amar, to reflect in their experience that they didn't realise what they're falling down on. So it's not always outside criticism coming in. So while that might seem that I'd be particularly hard on our students, I'm not. And I think our students are exceptional to work with. I'm delighted to do so. That is me, and I've taken up the question.
Do we ask all the questions?
Sorry, we're having a technical pause.
Is that helps? Is that lighting okay watching?
Are you okay watching that? Just to facilitate those that we're live streaming.
That's an awful lot clearer on the line.
Okay, well that's good. Could you pull up on the screen so we can talk about the module? Are you on loop?
Look
at the online stuff.
Okay, so we're nearly there. It's Friday evening. Interesting, there's a hint of switching off the lights, they've been dark already. I just wanted to talk for a few minutes about the module, because I know I'm looking around the class, three or four of you are interested in the module, and we're also live streaming this and recording it, so what I'm saying is actually going to be looked at by other people who couldn't make it, who are specifically interested in the module. We circulated the brochure. It's in your pack, Jeanette here. I have to thank Jeanette here, who helped us with preparing all the packs and preparing the room and the sandwiches, and everything seemed to happen quietly in the background. So thank you for that, Jeanette. Jeanette works here in Invent on a number of different projects, and she also provides legal support in working on developing social entrepreneurship across the campus. And she's also one of the faculty advisors with an Aptus and keeping the GCU and Aptus team in shape and so on. So
I want to talk to you about our module on enterprise and entrepreneurial learning, the level 9 module that Peter and I developed last year and ran for a pilot program under the auspices of ACE, Accelerated Campus Entrepreneurship, which was funded by the UGA. ACE has morphed itself into a new organisation called Seeing Campus Entrepreneurship Education Network. Maybe when I finish at the end, Bridget, you might say a few words. I didn't ask you to do that much.
Oh, so thank you.
You might do it just 2 or 3 minutes at the end.
Working on your pressure to be entrepreneurial characters.
Yes. In light of the conversation we had yesterday's meeting. in general. So basically, ACE was about accelerating campus entrepreneurship. And we felt that one of the best ways of doing this was to provide academics and non-academics in the HEI sector throughout the country with the opportunity to develop their own skills and understanding, their thinking, to network and become a community of practice. And then the people, with all this continual professional development, the people in these schools have some kind of accreditation. And there's nothing like homework to get people to actually learn. And I was always amused when I get the email from a certain gentleman. I got one from Michael, actually, I remember last year. Can I have an extension of the deadline? And then in brackets, God, I feel like a student. I took a module about 2 years ago myself on teaching online. And I wrote the same email asking for an extension. And it was only by going through a module and being registered as a student at VCU and having a student email account and a student card and everything that I really empathised with the lived experience of a student of that time. I was doing a master's level module, kind of a variation of this topic. So actually, part of what Peter and I do when we run this module is to let people go through that lived experience of being students. And we had the usual grumbles from some of the students and participants. We kept stopping calling them students, but the usual grumbles that we get from our real students. But by going through the process anyway, you get a much better understanding of what students are going through. So it's basically a 10 credit postgraduate module. It's a standalone 10 credits from us, that's it. It's nothing grander than that. It's not a certificate in anything or a diploma in anything. But if you wanted to take it further, you can use this as a linked module in the LIN suite of modules, which would ultimately lead to a postgraduate diploma or indeed a master's in teaching and learning. So if you look at LIN.ie, Learning Innovation Network, that was developed by a number of the Institute of Technology and is led from AFLOW. So they recognise this module as being one of the contributing modules to building up your portfolio of modules in that system.
So if you were to do this module, you would need to do 4 other 5-credit modules and a capstone module in that IT, and that would lead to a postgraduate qualification. So
qualification, and then you can do a top that up with a master's. So if you wanted to build up a very practically oriented master's program in teaching and learning, that's an option. So anyway, we're running this module again. It ran very well last year. We were very happy that of the 23 people who joined the module, 20 of them successfully completed it. The other 3 left the module due to genuine bad illnesses. So we were glad. We look at it as essentially as 100% completion rate, that everybody stayed the course on the module. We conducted an external evaluation. We paid an external evaluator to come in, interview the 2 of us, interrogate all the materials that we had, all the materials that had gone through, get the module accredited. And she attended one of the workshops, a full-day workshop like this, and she interviewed a lot of the participants on the program, and we took on board some of the feedback that came from. We took on board all the feedback that we got on that.
So you were very selective.
We actually took on board, largely it was very positive. We were happy to see. And I'm delighted to have 3 of the graduates here. And Emma from Dundalk was with us as well today, although she wasn't here in speaking capacity. So the workshop was on the basis of 3 on-campus workshops in this room, literally, from February to April. And then we have a series of webinars online,
And then we have a series of online learning objects that we also use. We use this platform in DCU. It's an online learning platform called Loop. Last year it was called Moodle. In other places, a similar system is called Blackboard. So all the materials are available online through this system once the students have registered online.
So just the distinction between the online learning resources are asynchronous, so you can go through those in your own time. So we just set a specific period of time, maybe a week, and we'd log on and go through as much of the information as you want, and then you can pause and start back where you left off. And then the webinars are live, so that would be just a live online lecture with myself and Emo with live participation, but they're also recorded. But if you can't make it during a specific session, you can re-watch the video, but obviously then you wouldn't be able to ask questions.
And the only technology you need to do all of this is web access. If you can listen to music online on your own computer, you can listen to the webinars, and then you just need a microphone so that you can speak and participate in the webinar. If there's something wrong with your microphone, which sometimes happens, you can type in a question into the webinar and everybody can see the question. So there's a number of different ways there. So there's no big grand IT systems required.
During the first workshop, we spent a bit of time doing some test runs on it.
Literally I was outside the room and we were on the webinar. I was broadcasting from down the corridor. People could see how it could work. People talk about MOOCs, and Mark Brown earlier on spoke about MOOCs and about online learning. Can you go into one of the online learning resources you showed? They're down below the three workshops. So this is an online learning resource. So you go through time, you can skim through it for an hour, or you can delve into every single aspect of it for a couple of hours. Oh dear.
No, that's fine.
Okay, sorry, Peter's a techie. I get all fretful and sorry. It'll work.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So you navigate your own way through this. You click, you listen, you read, and so on.
Is this taking you back?
Yeah.
I thought it was
our student is.
First day, it's out.
Entrepreneurship is not simply a model for now. The word has been in use since the beginning, just not in particular in the last century.
To click around and just show.
So we show this all the time anyway, but it's fairly straightforward. There's simple navigation forward and backwards, and then a lot of the slides will have clickable areas where you can, you'll notice them highlight. You can highlight and find more information, and that will have its own sound. And in some of the slides, you'll be able to click on a references list where you have links to online articles or other information about either what's on the slide or some further reading and more information.
So what we're saying is that you can delve into this far more deeply than, or you can skim through it, once and then go back and say, I like that, I look into that. So, for example, you could click here and read the article by Jacopo Dodd, Jack and Anderson. You could click into books and references and so on. So you delve down as deeply as you wish. And in a way, we're providing a huge suite of information, of resources and so on, and you decide, well, I really want to specialise in this. I've no interest in all these definitions of the whole academic entrepreneurship. I'm really more interested in the education. So when you get to the learning resource that Peter developed in education, you might delve far more into his rather than mine. So Peter had, you designed one on innovation and one on education.
Yeah.
I designed this one on entrepreneurship, and I have another one that just finishing up on social entrepreneurship. So these are available for you to go through in your own time and to use them.
So they are multimedia, and they do have active links. So I suggest you don't have to read absolutely everything, and you wouldn't have to read absolutely everything, but if you found an area of interest, you can click off the links into that. So they have visual text, and then they all have voiceovers, so we talk through the slides and try not to just read what's there, we just give a summary of what's on the screen. And we've also tried to make them interactive in that at the start of each of the resources and at different stages throughout, we'll ask you different questions. So what at the beginning of this resource would be your understanding of, let's say, entrepreneurship? And you might fill in some answers. And then at a midway point, we'll show you your current understanding, and then you can reflect on how your understanding has changed since going through the material. So we try and make them interactive as well, so it's not just listening to us for
an hour. Too long.
So we've kind of based it on those four pillars. So there's key concepts around entrepreneurship, creativity and innovation, then education and entrepreneurship, and then social entrepreneurship. So each of those has a learning resource associated with it, which is this is an example of. And then on top of those, we have different webinars that flesh out those details. And we have guest lecturers who've joined us online from the...
Yeah, for the webinars, we run some of the webinars ourselves, which is about, I suppose, reinforcing some of the stuff that's covered in these online resources or in the seminars here on campus. But also we bring in guest lecturers. So, for example, Paula Fitzsimons, who works on the Global Entrepreneurship Monitor, which is a report that has a fair amount of influence in enterprise policy in Enterprise Ireland and the IDA and the local enterprise offices and so on. She did and she's full of opinions. And for her, enterprise is very much about setting up a business, employing people, making money, growing the business. And that's one aspect of entrepreneurship, so it's very important to hear the voice of somebody who does have a lot of influence in entrepreneurship. She also works on a programme for specifically for women who are heading up high-growth enterprises. It's a mentorship programme called Going for Growth for Women. So she was one of our guest lecturers last year. We had another person, Dr. Klaus Seiler, from one of the universities in Munich, who is involved in a number of EU-funded projects and working with the OECD, and he gave a guest lecture as well. So he was literally sitting in his office over in Munich, and he delivered the webinar from Munich. And then, Peter, you brought in Daniel Feligood, all the way from the United States. He was sitting in his office in the United States, and he led the webinar with us. We were, I suppose, chairing it and doing the technical support for him as he webinar.
We're trying to get a range of people from different industries. So David Velgo was from engineering.
Yes.
And we have people from social enterprise, and the same with the workshops as well. We try to get people from business angles, but also from the arts, and from social enterprise, from traditional enterprise, just so you can get a number of different perspectives and see how different people are approaching the idea of how do I embed entrepreneurial behaviours in my own learning, and see it from a number of different perspectives.
Yeah, another one we did was, here in the seminar, we had Sean Love from Fighting Words came in. This is a project to develop writing skills through creative writing and the freedom of creativity to second level school children, with a heavy emphasis on children coming from disadvantaged schools. So he actually did a creative writing workshop with us here where participants wrote a story live, collaboratively and so on. And that was just a more of this experiential thing. God, I feel like a student, or God, I've been challenged in terms of my, literacy and my creativity in terms of storytelling and narration. So the structure in terms of delivery is the three workshops, the series of webinars. We have one a week, and then the online learning tools. And they are the main modes of delivery, let's say, that we have. And then in terms of the subject matter, Peter discussed that a minute ago, in terms of the assignments that are involved, the homework, the hard bit, we have two assignments. Gentlemen, you'll be glad to hear that there was part of the feedback we got last year was that there were too many assignments, so thank you for being required. You have your uses as guinea pigs. There will be two assignments, but bear in mind that the merging of two assignments is going to create a slightly bigger assignment. It's not just one small one, it's now one nice.
It's all about optics. Two assignments.
Two assignments. Anyway, the first assignment will be a group assignment where you will work in groups. We will put you into those groups. You will need to work remotely. One of the complaints that we did get, which we didn't take on board, it was it's very hard to work with people online. It's very hard, you know. I mean, that's life. That's the way the world works at the moment. I'm working remotely on a project with people in California. It means I sit in my office at 5 o'clock in the evening and I'm on a Skype call with them over in the States. because they're 8 hours behind and so on.
However, what we do is set up group space for you to work. So we'll set up a webinar space for each of the groups, which eventually worked. We worked out some of the kinks. There was some kinks at the start where we'll set up a group space. So if you're involved in a group project, you can just arrange a time to meet on this Moodle page, log into your group area, and there'll be live chat, like live Skype with all of the group where you can share documents, share ideas. But we will provide a space for you.
Yes, so we're facilitating with that. And then since we ran all of this last year, we have this grand new director of our Centre for Digital Learning, Mark Brown. So, you know, we're aiming to be what we say we are here in DCU, is to allow people to include those kind of aspects of online learning. The major assignment for the module is actually the project you want to work on in your own HEI, in your own institution, as to how you would like, or how your manager would like you, or your the director or the president or the dean of your faculty or whatever, the head of department, would like you to work on in your institution. So it could be something like devising the new module that Mike would have to work on. So Mike would have the opportunity to develop that module that he spoke about earlier on in the context of developing it with all of this support around him in terms of colleagues, but in terms of all the materials and the learning that he was doing as well. That was one example. Well, Gabriel did the same thing within a module that you have designed already, you were about to design, you were working on it, you have the new product design, and you end up dealing with them. Then we had people who were working on a campus-wide project. So, for example, your Kearney McCarthy in Mary I in Limerick, she wanted to develop a suite of, you know, these summer continual professional development courses that primary school teachers can do during the summer. She developed some materials there so that instead of going off and learning more about geography or going off and spending a few days in the Gaels fine-tuning their Irish, they can say, I'll take these online learning resources on entrepreneurship and it'll help me embed entrepreneurship in my own teaching in my own primary school, which I'm teaching. So that was her project. So people worked on different projects and then they got support from us and from other people in the group in developing those projects.
So really the focus is on embedding entrepreneurial learning entrepreneurship in your own institution or your own organization, whether that's as an academic, a non-academic, whatever discipline you teach in, and it's just in whatever way. So we talk about this at the start, that it is about making a step forward, so that if it's something you've never done before, it might be embedding some entrepreneurial learning in an existing module that you have and will work with you to do that. If you already do that, it might be expanding it out and developing that further. So we don't prescribe exactly what we want you to do. It's more helping you to think about where you'd like to take it and then helping you to develop a proposal on how you want to do it.
So it's a matter of running your proposal by us to see if it's sufficient to satisfy the requirement, the learning requirements of our module, but at the same time you're running it by the relevant stakeholders in your own organisation to see that they are happy that you work on this, and in part of the feedback that we give you when you're going through it, it's about helping you in bringing that to your various stakeholders and getting them to buy into it. After all, we're hoping that your employer is going to pay your fee to take the module, and therefore, if they're giving you the time off, hopefully as well as paying the fee for it, in terms of your workload, it's about it being of use in your own higher education institution. Or you might be looking at it just as your own career development. You might be on a 3-year contract, and you might be saying, well, you know, I really need to be gearing myself up to be more marketable at the end, or so that I can get a job where I am, or get a job elsewhere where I am. So it's wide open, the projects that people can work on, and as we said, we have people from all kinds of disciplines, from primary school teaching over to engineering, we have food science, we have graphic designers,
culinary arts,
yes, so there are all kinds of different subjects, home economics, yeah, there were all kinds of different subjects, and people interpreted or made use of the assignment in loads of different ways, suited them and where they were in their careers and where they were in their own institution and so on.
We do try to provide a range of literature in each of the areas as well. We don't focus on every single part. We try, if we focus on a certain area, to provide backup literature in other areas as well. So if we're not talking specifically about your subject area one week, there will be supporting literature there for you to look through and get ideas from.
Yeah, we cover a lot of the policy development at a national and at a European level as well. Hopefully this year we'll be using even more of the overseas speakers than we had last year, because they have a lot to offer, and we're obviously working in a national context, but also in a European Union context and an international context. So that's it.
Questions,
anybody, any questions?
The other assignment, did you explain?
So that we said that we're merging two assignments and come to a group assignment.
Yeah, we didn't say what it was. Yeah.
It's on policy and looking at entrepreneurship education in your area.
It's about entrepreneurship policy and then entrepreneurship education policy. Because there's two strands going on at European Commission and at national level. At one stage you've got the DG for Enterprise and Industry saying, oh, we need more entrepreneurship in the education system. And at the same time, you have DG Education and Training saying, you know, we need to embed entrepreneurship and so on. So we look at all those different policy documents, and the same thing is happening here in Dublin as well. So it's about pulling those various aspects together. It strengthens your case then if you're making a case in your own institution as to why you believe that this type of stuff should be embedded in whatever subject it is that you teach. Yeah, sorry, thanks for that. Any other questions?
So what's the group assignment then? Is there a deadline?
That is the group assignment. It's working on the policy documents. So that you have that groundwork of knowing why you want to do this, rather than that you have a bee in your bonnet yourself that you want your students to be more this or more that. It's about being able to look at the documents, see what the trends are, look at the trends in entrepreneurship education. You know, there's some of them. Well, they were there a minute ago. You had Alan Gibbs' work. So, for example, Alan Gibbs would have been a highly influential, has been a very highly influential person in terms of the development of entrepreneurship education over Britain. Okay, so he's written some interesting papers. Just an example. So we allude to various documents like that. We lead you to where you can read more about them.
Is it the same percentage for both?
No, there was 30% for the group assignment and 70% for your individual assignment. One of the other things you can do as well is that, you know, if you have an interest in a particular country, like if you look at the Scandinavian countries, and I do know where they are on the map, students still modify that bit, but whatever. You know, the whole thing of the history of good design, physical design, product design, and so on, if that's your field, what PJ might have more likely looked at, well, what's the policy in Finland to do with design education? So something I can learn there, okay? Or it might be that you're interested in high technology and you might go and say, well, like, I want to look at what's going on in France. Or at one stage somebody decided to look at Poland and we had to find documents that would describe the entrepreneurship policy in Poland, because they happen to have published some number of documents in English. I don't speak read Polish, but I was able to find the documents, pass them on to the students, the participants in question. You might be doing something in food, so you might be going to learn about food entrepreneurship policy. Is there anything particular in that? So it's wide open for you to apply it in whichever of your own domains and disciplines you're interested in.
Yes?
It's hard work. It's one of the pieces of feedback that last year's participants gave, but we ran it from September to the end of March, and they felt it was too long drawn out, and that a short, sharp shock in one semester would be better than having it drawn out over two semesters. There were some complaints about the workload, and I will say, yes, I actually make no apologies for that. It is a 10-credit module. I've gone through a similar thing myself with the online learning. Yes, this is what we put our own students through. If you really want to learn about this subject and do it properly, this is the workload. But be sensible and do the stuff that's going to be of relevance to your particular.
So while it is a blended module, and we will do workshops, but I suppose maybe there was the illusion of, because some of it was online, that it was more like a MOOC, which is kind of dip in and out, but it is, the workload there is the equivalent of a 10 credit module, even though we're delivering a lot of it online, so there is that level of work.
Can I ask the three gentlemen who took the module last year and survived, came out the other end, came back up
here today? He would be better commenting on that than we would.
Yeah. Very comprehensive. The amount of material that goes together was amazing. I suppose it just goes back to what I said earlier about entrepreneurship, the level is loaded as well, the level is the same thing. Because you get a real good grounding of the I suppose, the good framing of what entrepreneurship is, and you can start applying to yourself in your own situation. That's what it's all about. The amount of, it's very, very well structured, and there's incredible resources, incredible resources. Like with those clips that you have there, if you start start peeling underneath the layers, there's lots and lots of resources there, and you kind of go into, you can start going down a rabbit hole. If you're interested, you can kind of go off in different areas, whatever way you want, and it's really, really complex. That's one word that I want to describe the resources that you want to get.
Yeah, it's certainly great that. The content is very, very useful. I think from my own experience, you've got to make time for it.
Yeah.
Just got to make time. Somehow squeeze time on your schedule and say, that's it, that's for me, to make it happen. Never easy.
But no, but if you, equally, if there's an area that's kind of that you want to kind of look at and start, and you can go through the last year to apply to your given area, and you get feedback. It's great, it's really good.
Like, we gave everybody individual comprehensive feedback. Like, it could have been a whole page of text online of, we've read your proposal and we think this bit is great, we think this bit is not so great, we think this bit better than that bit. These are the areas for improvement, and did you ever think of this, did you ever think of that? So some people got up to a whole page of text of feedback to help move on with the project.
And sometimes it was, you know, this is excellent, but you're changing the world, this is a 10 credit module, maybe just focus on this little piece of
this 10 credit
module.
If you need me to draw back and say, whoa, we ain't going to do all that in this module.
Like, we'd love you to do that and possibly follow on for this next year or next semester, absolutely go and do all these things that you plan to do. But for, if it's just for this assignment on its own, it's 10 credits, maybe pair back on what you're trying to achieve just for this part, this proposal part.
But for me, that's what formal kind of academic rigor behind what entrepreneurship is. It's like, you know, if that just have been a level, it's more like a term.
It's kind of in fashion. There's an element of being in fashion, and it's very easy to take a light approach to it. But this, you know, this is informed by research, it's informed by policy, and it's all there for you to back up your own arguments when you're putting your own proposal together. And essentially, the proposal you give us as your assignment can be in the format in which you need to put it forward through your own systems. So, for example, for us to go through getting this module accredited, we bring that module through hoops. And I thought, how many other building committees in this damn university do I have to go this through? Like, sometimes I feel I'm working in the Innovation Prevention Unit. That's our table. And then they want something to change, you say, oh, for God's sake, you're just showing that you know, that you've read the documents and so on. So, I mean, but we have to go through all of that to get it accredited, right up to, you know, Education Committee and Academic Council. So, you know, you can put your proposal for us, the bulk of it can be in the format of the document you need to present to whoever senior management is in your place. With an added bit, you know, of your own reflection, of your own learning, and so on for us.
I agree with the concur with the answer. I also like to say it was, I found it very beneficial to be part of the community. maybe working away by yourself in a particular area when you're lecturing, but be part of, I'm a big fan of meeting people, even though a lot of this online stuff, it's very good, but we have just people who work together, the interaction we have online, and I found that to bring up to speed and be part of the community, that was another aspect that I found really enjoyable.
And one of the things that we haven't worked out yet, but is that we're hoping as well that we can create some kind of a mechanism whereby the new cohort can network with the first cohort. You know, and that's part of the reason we specifically asked the PJ, Michael and Gabriel to come back as well, because it's about that community of practitioners.
It's a conversation.
Yeah. That's right. That's
stay connected.
Any other questions? Okay, well, spread the news far and wide. The deadline for the module, before I finish everything back to closing up, I do want Bridget to say a few words about STEAM. But spread the news about the module. The deadline is this day week, Friday the 12th. It's a very short application, two-page application form. It's essentially the information the university wants, and you know, the name, date of birth, and you know, whether that's your temporary address or not, although those kind of things are on the form. But also, we just need a good one or two paragraphs of why you want to do this module, why you should get this on the module. And then the following week, Peter and I will be working on offering places. We think we might have more applications than we have spaces, but we don't know. That will all depend on what comes into us, you know, after the 12th or on the 12th. But we hope to, you know, review them following week and send, you know, it'll be an email from us. You know, they're coming to you through a registry, send it over to us, and we'll just sit there and write, dear Mary, dear Jenny, dear Johnny, and so on. So send on the email. And then if we end up with more places than we available, what we will do then is that same day we send out the offers, we'll send an email out saying we're taking some more offers by January. So we've got quite a quick turnaround time, so that and part of that is to make sure that everything is in place for the 6th of February, and also in having the form signed by your line manager and saying that they're giving you the fee for it and so on, makes it easier for us to invoice your university for it or your college for the fee. And it also strengthens the case for you to get your line manager to realise this is for real and to hopefully relieve you of some other responsibilities while you take the module.
So essentially you can get the college to pay you guys directly?
That's why we've asked for the fee over it. So basically, you know, I got advice from similar setups. It makes it easier, like, because there's no way we can let you in here without having paid your fee.
Oh, right.
Okay, but if it's from St. Pat's, somebody in St. Pat's has signed it off,
oh, okay,
it's much easier for us to charge it from St. Pat's up to here.
Oh, okay. Very
yeah. It means it's not going through your cash flow.
What number did you say? Is it through a number, Eimear? But a number,
just a purchase order number.
A purchase order, yeah. It's on the form. And your line manager will only have the school of beverages right, will understand. Any other questions? Okay, before we finish, I'm just going to give Bridget, you have to stay there and just speak for a few minutes. What exactly is the scene and where we're at the moment, because we want to get more people involved in the network.
I'm going to race through it.
Okay,
my role is National Project Officer for Campus Entrepreneurship Educators Network, which is SEEM. To explain that, I just need to say a few words about ACE, which is the precursor of the success organisation. ACE, and I think most of you will know a little bit about ACE, because I think I've presented to most of you at some point. The Accelerated Campus Entrepreneurship Initiative was a partnership of five HEIs, funded by the HEA. It's all about embedding entrepreneurship in the curriculum, and particularly in non-business studies areas, so engineering particularly was highlighted. And it was also the definition of entrepreneurship education was enterprise for life, in terms of life skills as well as new venture creation. So it was a very, very broad definition. The approach taken was very holistic. It wasn't just about introducing modules, it was about looking at the HEI in its entirety, looking at the leadership, engaging the leadership to
commit to embedding entrepreneurship within the curriculum, so mission statements, strategic objectives, and so on, just creating the right culture across the organisation. So supports were put in at that level. The main area of support was put in with the educators to support educators to be good teachers of entrepreneurship, and that was around entrepreneurship education programs like this and other trainer programs, and a lot of other supports, like a group went over to Babson College and did a very intensive program over there. So a lot of intense work with educators. The other area was actually engaging students, so as they are the ones that have to put all of this stuff in practice. So it was a number of initiatives to engage the students, to excite them about entrepreneurship, and that was things like student enterprise societies, enterprise interns, which were paid students who actually worked to engage other students in these non-curricular enterprise opportunities, like competitions, things like that. So the programme, so in terms of what it produced, lots of new programmes, new modules, new research, case studies, learning resources, they were all available. The programme was evaluated, I'm written up by Simon over there. So there is an evaluation document if you want to learn more about it. It's available on the SEAM website. SEAM completed in June 2014. It was relaunched as SEAM. And the idea behind SEAM, ACE completed in 2014. And it was relaunched as SEAM on the same day. And the whole thing about SEAM is that we want to make it available to any KGI that's interested in participating. So it isn't just the consortium, it's anybody really. And we're working through at the moment how we actually make that happen in practice. And we will communicate with everybody early in January around how we invite more people to be part of it. But in terms of our programme of activity at the moment, the main areas, our main funding from the HEA is finished. We have some network funding from the Teaching and Learning Forum to keep the basic central organisation stuff going. Also, the existing partners are funded as well. Thank you, partners. The main areas of delivery, our main programme is the education programme. That's perhaps the most important thing, and so many other things come out of that. So that's, I suppose, our showcase programme. But the other very important programmes are the Engaged Student Project that I referred to earlier on. At the moment, that's five HEIs, students working together to develop a national entrepreneurship, our Student Enterprise Society Network. They've got five HEIs involved at the moment. They've built wonderful resources and a lot of really good partnership work between them to support, and some staff here have been involved in that programme. Really good collaboration between them. They've set themselves a target of extending that to 8 HEIs by the end of March. So if any HEI is interested or has students that are interested, let me know and I can put them into contact with the students. We're also working with the USI on that as of last week, so there's lots of potential for expanding that work nationally. Another area that we're looking at, and this is based on feedback from the participants in the Educators Programme last year, and we have to shape this, is to look at a mentoring programme for educators that are new to this area. So if entrepreneurship education isn't your area, and you're starting out in it, it may be good to work alongside some people who have been doing this for some time. So we have to shape that. Another area is, we talked about an emerging community of practice. We will have a national conference just to facilitate that networking, to have a community of practice, and we're looking to do that in April, May time. So, and we will contact everybody. And then finally, we have established a website where we're trying to put all of our information, a lot of learning resources, a lot of policy documents. So hopefully that will be useful to you. And if you have anything that you think will be of value to the wider network, please share that as well. But the idea is that's just.
And will that be on the website? The database.
Yeah, it's a growing database.
Yeah.
Of at the moment, it's a lot of our stuff, the stuff that we've developed through ACE. all the policy documents are there, all the QQI. We're also working with the QQI on developing standards for entrepreneurship education as well. That's taken a while so far, but that's why Barbara was here today, to give her a better understanding of that practice. So that's just a bit of an overview of what's happening. Any questions for Bridget? Okay, that's it. I hereby announce 7 hours is over. Thank you very much. Thank you all. I hope very much for our guests. So, if anybody needs a taxi, number one, time's off to take a taxi to the Connolly Station. So, is there anybody going to Connolly Station? I'm sure you can share a taxi with Simon. No? Okay, right, Simon, you're on your own. You're taxiing,
right?
Oh, if you want George's key, that's just well, then you might share a taxi.
Yeah,
great. And if anybody else needs a taxi, if you go down to Maeve downstairs at the reception desk, she can call a taxi. Yes. And if anybody wants to take sandwiches or anything else, please. No, I mean, genuine about this.